Before writing, before metal, before even the names of gods were whispered across stone, there was the circle. It appeared everywhere, long before humanity understood it was looking. In the sky, where the sun carved arcs across the seasons. In the pupil of an animal watching through the dark. In the ripple of a stone cast into still water. And in each of those places, there was something uncanny, repetitive, unbroken. A shape that seemed complete. Among the first civilizations to press reed into clay, the Babylonians looked at the heavens and the flow of rivers and saw those circles too. Around 4,000 years ago, they reached for a ratio. They didn't call it P. Of course, they called it nothing. They simply felt it. That if you wrapped a string around a circle and then stretched it straight, it always gave you about 3 times across.
Not exactly.
But close. 3 1/8, to be precise. That is, 3.25. By today's standards, it's crude. But imagine, this number was born at a time when iron was only just being melted into tools and mammoths had only recently gone silent in the frost. That humans could even approach the idea of pi is as audacious as building pyramids without wheels. Meanwhile, the Egyptians, with their obsession for cosmic alignment and geometry in stone, offered a rival guess. 3.16, less accurate than Babylon, but no less remarkable. Because whether by papyrus or sand or chisel, they all faced the same problem. How do you measure a curve with only straight lines? Here's the conundrum. A circle refuses corners. It has no sides, no breaks. So how does one measure it with logic? The ancients cheated cleverly. Instead of a circle, they began with the square, a shape they could count. 4 equal sides, measurable, knowable. Then they imagined shapes with more sides. A pentagon, still rough. A hexagon, getting closer. A heptagon, then an octagon. With each new side, the shape began to whisper the curve of the circle. Mathematicians slowly realized that a circle could be thought of as a polygon with infinite sides. And then came Archimedes. 200 years before the Common Era, the Greek thinker stood at the bleeding edge of what the mind could conceive. The world to him was geometry in motion, planets as curves, levers as law, and circles as mysteries demanding precision. He wanted to know pi not as an estimate, but as a truth. So, he carved 2 polygons, one inside a circle, one outside it, the first pressed up against the circle's inner edge, the second hugging its outer curve. Each had 6 sides, then 12, then 24. With each increase, the outer and inner perimeters narrowed toward the same value. Somewhere between them, the truth of pi was trapped like a hunted animal. He pushed onward, 48 sides, 96, until his shapes resembled shadows of perfection. From these, he deduced pi lies between 3.1408 and 3.1429. For the first time in history, someone had cornered a curve. Not exactly, but close enough to shake the earth beneath mathematical certainty. This was more than geometry. It was philosophy etched in ratios. The notion that by enclosing the infinite with patience and logic, one could tame it. And yet, this final triumph would also be Archimedes' undoing. In 212 BC, as Roman legions stormed the Sicilian city of Syracuse, Archimedes sat in the sand, drawing his figures. According to the whispers of history, a soldier approached. Perhaps he barked orders. Perhaps he demanded silence. But Archimedes only replied, "Do not disturb my circles." Then he was gone. With him, Europe's pursuit of pi died for over 1,000 years. The libraries that might have carried his work were burned. The symbols that might have extended his thinking were lost beneath the weight of wars and plagues. Pi was no longer a pursuit. It became, once again, a riddle sleeping in the margins of forgotten scrolls.
But not everywhere.
While the West sank into silence, a different voice began to hum. From China, from India, from Persia, a whisper traveled. Curves still mattered. Circles still breathed. And pi had not yet revealed all its digits. In the East, the circle would not be disturbed. While Europe's scrolls crumbled in monasteries and memory, the pursuit of pi quietly shifted continents. In the East, far from the fading echoes of Rome, mathematics was not lost, it was being reborn. In China, a man stood alone with ink and brush, Zhu Chongzhi. He lived 1,000 years after Archimedes, but reached deeper into the circle's secret. He didn't just approximate pi. He hunted it with polygons whose sides numbered in the thousands, 3,072 to be exact. Where the Greeks had stopped at 96, he kept going.
His estimate?
3.1415926. Correct to 7 digits. A number so precise that it would not be surpassed for nearly 800 years. But Zhu did not shout. He did not carve his name into marble or inscribe monuments to his genius. Like many Eastern mathematicians of the time, his knowledge was a river flowing quietly, reshaping the landscape without demanding praise. Meanwhile in India, something astonishing was unfolding. It began not with pi itself, but with the way numbers were written. Imagine, for a moment, trying to subtract 70 from 125 using Roman numerals. It's a battlefield of letters, CXXV minus LXX. No zero, no place value, no symmetry. But the Indians had a different idea. 10 digits, one symbol for nothing, and the position of each digit changes its meaning. Decimal notation, the silent revolution. Combine that with something even more explosive, a system to describe the unknown. An equation, x plus 70, 125. Subtract 70, you find x over 55. Simple to us, impossible without two concepts. One, symbols for all numbers. Two, algebra, the ability to speak of what is not yet known and to manipulate it like clay. These weren't just abstract tools. They were weapons, sharpened across centuries by Persian minds like Muhammad ibn Musa al-Khwarizmi, whose very name would give us the word algorithm. He codified the techniques to balance equations, shift terms, and isolate variables. He opened the door for mathematics to be written like music, fluid, logical, infinite. And with these tools, the hunt for pi resumed. No longer was it just about measuring curves. Now, it was about understanding them. Not with string and polygons, but with functions and infinite series. A way to add endlessly smaller parts together and land precisely on a number that could not be caught by geometry alone. Back in India, during the 14th century, a school of scholars near the southern tip of the subcontinent began something no one else had dared. They began writing trigonometric functions as infinite series. The Kerala school, led by the enigmatic Madhava of Sangamagrama, unlocked the sine, cosine, and tangent functions like never before. But more importantly, they used these expansions to calculate pi. Here's how it worked. If you write the inverse tangent function, arctan x, as an infinite series, and plug in x over 1, you start inching toward p4, so multiply by 4. And with enough terms, you get p. They didn't just try this. They succeeded. Madhava estimated pi to 11 decimal places, centuries before Europe would rediscover the same method. And then, silence again, like a wave that reaches its crest and falls quietly back into the sea. Madhava's work slipped into obscurity. Some of it was preserved, whispered through manuscripts, but most would be forgotten, until, unknowingly, European minds would begin to stumble upon the same secrets. Much later, this was not theft. It was convergence, the mind of humanity tuning into a truth so fundamental that even divided by oceans, cultures found their way back to it. So while the West would later celebrate Newton and Leibniz, while they would craft calculus and name it new, the numbers had already danced in the East. The circle had already been uncoiled. By the early 17th century, as Europe began to stretch its limbs in the first light of the scientific revolution, the East had already mapped the shadows. And though their voices were quiet, their influence was irreversible. The tools had been forged. Decimal notation, algebra, trigonometry, series, and behind them all, the endless whisper, pi. Not as a number to be tamed, but a companion, a mirror to the mind's own desire to chase the infinite. Europe awoke. Enlightenment spread like fire across ink-stained maps. From the silence of medieval cathedrals rose the hum of laboratories, the scratch of pens birthing new theorems. And at the center of it all, again, eternally, was pi. But this time, the circle was no longer being chased by geometry. It was being summoned by logic. In 1671, a Scottish mathematician named James Gregory did something uncanny. He rewrote the inverse tangent function as an infinite series. Then came Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz, whose version of the same idea gave the world a deceptively simple equation. An alternating rhythm, an elegant whisper of infinity. But the equation was deceptive. Add a million terms, and you still only get pi to five decimal places. The road is long, the path exhausting. So the competition began, not for the answer, but for how fast one could get there. In 1699, Abraham Sharp pushed pi to 71 digits. In 1706, John Machin doubled it to 100. And in 1719, Thomas Delaunay brought the count to 112. Not because the world demanded it, not because engineering required it, but because the circle had become a canvas for the intellect and pi the brush. They used series. They invented new ones. Some converged slowly. Others moved with startling precision. But all obeyed the same principle. The infinite can be understood if you are willing to walk its endless line, one digit at a time. It was no longer just math. It was art. It was ambition. And soon, it would be mechanical. In the early 20th century, a different kind of intelligence emerged, not born of thought, but of gears and wires. In 1949, an American engineer named John von Neumann, working with a team at the dawn of the computer age, decided to let the machine think. They fed it formulas, looped logic into circuits, and asked the impossible, how far can we go? The answer, 2037 digits of pi. A miracle then, a whisper now, because machines did not tire. They did not forget. They did not lose count. And so began a race where every finish line only revealed another. 10,000 digits, 100,000, 1 million. The numbers fell like stars from the sky. By the 21st century, pi had become the Everest of computational power. In 2019, Google engineer Emma Haruka Iwao calculated over 31 trillion digits of pi using cloud-based architecture. And then, just years later, Peter Trube and others shattered even that with more than 62. 8 trillion digits, a number that has no pattern, no loop, no end, just an eternal unfolding. A mirror into both the universe and the machine we use to decipher it. But why? Why chase pi into madness? The answer is both practical and poetic. On one hand, calculating pi is a perfect stress test. It pushes processors to their limits. It validates software. It proves the stability of hardware over days, months,
years.
On the other, pi is randomness within structure. Take any billion digits of pi, and you'll find every digit, 0 through 9, appears with near perfect frequency. In 200 billion digits, each number shows up about 20 billion times. Uniform, indifferent, infinite. To cryptographers, this makes pi a playground. To physicists, it is a calibration tool. To poets, it is a symbol. But most of all, to mathematicians, pi is a friend that never betrays. It always hides just one digit further, always dares you to take one more step. There is something deeply human in that. We crossed oceans not because we knew what was beyond, but because we didn't. We scaled mountains not because they were in the way, but because they stood there. And so, too, we chase pi. Because it is there. Because it has always been there. Because it connects every circle, from the orbit of the moon to the swirl of galaxies, to the quiet ring of a drop in still water. And because, though we may never reach the end, we are built to try. The number pi is more than a ratio. It is a fingerprint of the cosmos, spiraling through every equation, every structure, every breath. To calculate it is not just to chase a number, but to declare something profound. That infinity does not frighten us. It calls us forward.